Fraters and Sorors, the Imperator of the Rosicrucian Order, AMORC. The beauties of nature are a harmony of vibrations, of colors, sounds, scents, and geometrical forms. As you look upon a magnificent vista such as this, much of the phenomenon of its beauty is understandable to you. It is no longer thought that colors are inherent in objects, that, for example, the trees are actually green or the sky blue, as they seem. We now know in what manner we come to associate colors with the objects we perceive. In fact, our comprehension of how nature functions in certain realms heightens our enjoyment of her manifestations. So too, the human aura, the subject we are now to consider, is neither mysterious nor is it of the supernatural. The aura is the result of cosmic and natural laws, as are all other phenomena which we experience. In a discussion of the human aura and how it affects us, it is first necessary to begin with a brief analysis of its nature. Man's body has a radiation extending from it. We may liken this radiation to an electromagnetic field because it has characteristics similar to electricity and similar to magnetism. This radiation from the human body is vibratory, as are all energies. But it has, as we have said, magnetic qualities as well. That is, it has what we choose to call polarity, both positive and negative. The polarity manifests itself, or is evident to us, by the fact that the aura will at times attract and at other times repel, as will the magnetic field around the poles of a magnet. We call one of these polarities of the human aura positive, because it is the most infinite in its manifestations. It is more extensive. By contrast, the other polarity is negative, or finite, limited. The illustration shows, as a schematic diagram, these radiations and their polarities. The negative polarity of the human aura is the result of the material elements which we consume in our food. The human body itself is negative because it is an organic substance made up of the finite material substances of the earth. We replenish our body with finite substances, and so our physical body, generally speaking, is primarily negative. The other polarity of the aura, the positive, is a result of our taking into our lungs a creative energy of a very subtle and highly vibratory nature. This energy emanates to the earth from the sun. We take in this subtle force, this infinite vibratory essence, with each breath of life, and that constitutes the positive element and polarity of our aura. This positive vibratory quality that we take into our being with each breath is so high in its frequency, in the rapidity of its vibratory nature, that it exceeds the vibratory rates of any electrical energy known to man, that is, energy which we define as electrical. In our Rosicrucian teachings, we are also given instruction about the intonation of vowels and how beneficial they may be in many ways. We know that when we intone a vowel sound, we set up vibrations in the air around us. Through our intonations, we disturb the air, and the air becomes a medium for transmitting those disturbances or vibrations. Those vibrations may be conveyed to other persons who may hear them. As a result of their hearing them, or as a result of feeling these vibrations, the psychic centers of these persons are stimulated, are affected, and they respond psychically and emotionally to such vowels. These psychic centers are really transformers for changing the rates of vibrations that are high into a lower octave so that they will produce certain effects upon our organism and our mentality. In our illustration here, we show a few of these psychic centers. They are the pituitary, the pineal, and the thyroid glands. When these glands are aroused by the intonation of vowel sounds, they stimulate the sympathetic nervous system, which system is attuned with the cosmic forces. In consequence, there is caused a greater flow of the positive vital life force through our whole being, and the positive polarity of our aura increases. As a result, our aura is extended outward for an infinite distance, depending upon the amount of stimulation. Deep breathing adds to the positive polarity of the aura, for we take into our lungs the vital life force with its positive qualities. This energizes our being with a positive force. The excess of energy then, gained through deep breathing, not only radiates in our aura, but actually radiates from the radial nerves in each hand. The terminus of these radial nerves is located in the thumb and first two fingers. If we hold a glass of water by placing our hands around it and breathe deeply, we charge the content of that water with the positive radiations of our aura. Such water, after being charged by our aura, has a beneficial effect when taken internally. An aura truly does not have color, but it does produce color, or rather, it causes us to associate the idea of color with it. The aura frequency, that is, its vibratory rate, or we shall say its electromagnetic emanations, is so high that it is beyond the ocular range, beyond visible light. Consequently, it is actually impossible for the radiations of the aura directly to excite the retina of the eye. Being similar to an electromagnetic radiation, an aura can and does induce, that is, does bring about, vibratory changes in other energies. When the vibrations of an aura impinge on a field of light, that is, come in contact with a field of colored lights surrounding a human body, they produce a distinct change in the frequency or vibratory rates of that light. The impinging of the vibrations of the aura upon the field of light produces a subtle change in the color or light, but the change is sufficient to enable us to notice it objectively as a slight change in the field of light itself. In other words, what we are seeing then is not colors in the aura, but the effects which an aura produces on a field of light. Those then are the so-called colors of the aura. Actually, what we are seeing are the secondary effects of the aura upon light. You must realize that the sensation of color is in your brain and consciousness, not in the auric radiation. considerable experimentation has proved are associated with your authority and are the result of our thinking and deeds. We must impress upon you that these illustrations are not photographs of actual auras. They are representative of the colors we experience when we respond to auric vibrations. First, we have here the color purple. It indicates that the aura has a strong, positive, magnetic attraction. Its effects will extend far. It discloses that the character of the individual is honorable. There is as well considerable psychic development. Therefore, the purple aura is a positive one. Before us now is a representation of a predominantly violet aura. Notice the position of the aura as being principally around the head and shoulders of the subject. A violet aura depicts an individual who has an inquiring mind. He is a lover of truth and knowledge. It also indicates humility and a mystical zeal. The violet aura, too, is positive in its polarity. In an aura, the color green alludes to virginity. It also depicts aspiration to the finer, nobler things of life. It shows that the individual is spiritually unfolding. By that we mean that a psychic development is taking place. The aura, then, is likewise positive in its polarity. We must remind you that a positive aura may be projected infinitely through space. It becomes a vehicle for conveying the psychic self or the higher consciousness of self. When we wish to extend our aura, that is to project it outward to any great distance, it is the positive polarity that must be extended. In this illustration, we have a deep blue aura. The color blue is symbolic of the intellectual type of individual, the lover of truth. He is given to rationalizing, to thinking things through. He has a strong sense of justice, is spiritually inclined, and possesses strong moral precepts. This aura is also positive in its polarity. Remember, these colors are approximations. They are as similar to the color which you experience psychically when perceiving the actual aura sensations as it is possible to reproduce by mechanical means. Bright red, as associated with an aura, indicates that the individual is an extreme materialist. He is cynical about anything abstract or idealistic. Furthermore, the individual may be pugnacious and have a tendency toward brutality. He is definitely lacking in an aesthetic sense. He has little love of the fine and beautiful. Such an aura, as shown here, is negative in its polarity. When we are conscious of the color yellow in relation to an aura, as seen here, we know that the individual is philosophically inclined. He desires knowledge, but not merely for utilitarian reasons, as a profession or trade. He wants to know and derive satisfaction from the displacement of curiosity with facts. Such a person is also usually kind in his relation to others. He is noble in character. Such an aura, too, is positive in its polarity. Here we have a representation of a light blue aura. It signifies a sweet reasonableness and moral goodness. It depicts one who is temperate, not given to emotional impulsiveness, and who is tolerant in relation to others. This color in an aura indicates a positive polarity. It is a sign of progressive development of the soul personality. This color may perhaps be described as an orange-brown, as perceived in relation to an aura. It symbolizes one who is subtle, worldly wise, well-educated, and a lover of facts. He is one, however, who is disinclined toward abstract subjects such as metaphysics, mysticism, and philosophy. He is little concerned with the spiritual side of man's nature. Such a person may be tersely described as an agnostic. The polarity of his aura is negative. Before us now is a symbolic representation of a projection of an aura. The aura is projected from the head and shoulders. Though it is here shown rising in a vertical position, actually the aura may be projected in a circular manner, as a halo is seen around a street light on a foggy night. By putting the hands in the position shown, the aura around the head area may be intensified. All living things have an aura. The beauty we perceive in nature is not alone a matter of form, color, or scent. It often is a subtle radiation which we psychically perceive. May we urge you to refer again to your monographs for a more extensive explanation of what we have seen here on this occasion. The effects which we have seen were all produced in the Rosicrucian Technical Department Laboratories.